Aloha everyone, my name is Charles and this is the Hawaii Volcano Watch Report for July 2020. In this report, we will discuss the Mauna Loa Volcano, Kilauea Volcano, Lōʻihi Seamount, and the Halema'uma'u Crater Lake. Before I begin this report, I want to let everyone know, I am considering some changes to the format of the Hawaii Volcano Watch Report. These changes would merge status updates on the volcanic activity with a new weekly observation and investigation video series of the fissure rate system in Leilani Estates. The reason I am considering this change is due to the, lack of significant reportable activity or changes in the volcanic systems of the island. However, rest assured, I will post a special edition report to cover any significant changes or events if they occur. For now, I would like to hear from you. What do you think about this proposed change? Let me know down in the comment section below after you finish watching the video. Starting the report, we look at the Mauna Loa volcano first. In the first week of July, seismometers recorded 56 earthquakes that were less than magnitude 2.0 on the volcano. The majority of the quakes occurred at the shallow depths of 8 kilometers or less below sea level. However, on July 9th, a more significant earthquake of 3.3 in magnitude was detected on Mauna Loa's upper southwest rift zone. GPS systems continue to show the trend of the long-term, slowly increasing inflation of the summit. This trend would be considered consistent with magma supply to the shallow storage system of the volcano. As well, the gas concentrations and fumarole temperatures located at the summit and southwest rift zone sulfur cone continue to remain stable. The SO2 is reading below 2 parts per million and the temperatures are plus or minus 206 degrees Fahrenheit or 98 degrees Celsius. Finally, the webcams continue to show no changes in the volcano's landscape. That will do it for the Mauna Loa volcano. Next, we will take a look at Lōʻihi Seamount and see what is happening there. Since the May 11th earthquake swarm that occurred on the Lōʻihi Seamount, the quake activity has diminished. It appears Lōʻihi has returned to a state of rest and back to the average long-term rates of earthquake occurrences. There have been only 4 recent seismic events detected in the area of the Seamount. Next, please note, this is the last report on Lōʻihi I will include in the update. However, if there is any notable activity on Lōʻihi in the future, I will add it again to the report. Now over on Kilauea, during June, around 1,200 earthquakes were detected. That is around a 45% increase in events as compared to May. Of the 45%, most of the increase in quakes occurred under the upper east rift zone. That is an area that connects the summit to the east rift zone. Part of the increase also comes from a heightened activity detected deep below the summit of around 4 to 7 miles. This activity lasted for over 100 hours and occurred between June 13th and June 17th, 2020. Tilt meters located on the summit detected 7 deflation-inflation events over the past month. That is an increase of 3 DI events compared to a total of 4 recorded for the previous month. The increased deformation rates in the Middle East Rift Zone that started in March 2020 have returned to their pre-March trend after lessening and flattening during May. The long-term deformation trend of the Kilauea Summit and Middle East Rift Zone continues to show inflation, which again is consistent with magma supply to the shallow storage system of the volcano. Current gas emission rates of sulfur dioxide at the summit have not exhibited any changes that would indicate any significant shallowing of magma. It also appears the crater lake is continuing to absorb some of the sulfur dioxide gas. Measurements of the crater lake's water depth taken on June 30th indicate it was approximately 128 feet or 39 meters deep. USGS also reports that the last water sample collected was in January of 2020 and there are plans for additional sampling by an unmanned aerial system. Finally, sulfur dioxide emission rates continue to be below the detection limits at both Pu'o'o and the Lower East Rift Zone. It is now time to take a closer look at the Halema'uma'u Crater Lake. In this thermal video, taken on June 23, 2020, you can see the steam carried across the surface by the wind, which mostly masks the thermal features of the water surface. In this photo, also taken June 23rd, of the eastern end of the crater lake, the water appears to be slightly warmer. Observations of this location routinely show steam rising from its surface. In this close-up of the crater lake, you can see the ripples across the surface. These ripples appear to be generated by the wind and also possibly created in part by thermal convection currents. Periodic measurements of the lake depth indicate it is continuing to rise inside the crater. It would appear the influx of surrounding groundwater and percolating rainwater is the source of its continued growth. Moving on to June 30th, this photo shows a distinct and sharp color boundary between the dark brown and tan areas of the lake. At the bottom right of the picture, you can see a greenish area in the water. These greenish water areas correspond with the regions of higher temperatures as measured by the thermal imagery. Current speculation is they may represent the leading areas of water influx into the crater lake. The June 30th observations did not reveal any significant changes in the crater lake. The surface of the lake, however, did show some interesting color variations that day, though it appeared it would be within the same range as previously observed. I would also like to note that the distinct color boundary dividing the lake has become common. You can also see a wedge-shaped greenish zone in the west portion, towards the bottom of the image. Lastly, the laser rangefinder measurements did indicate a rise in the water level compared to the last recorded measurement. If you would like to receive a notification when the next Hawaii Volcano Watch Report is published, then be sure to click the subscribe button. Then click the bell icon and select all notifications. Also be sure to show that thumbs up button some aloha and give it a click too. Now for some really cool bonus content. When the Hawaii Department of Transportation cut through a portion of the Fissure 8 A'a lava flow, it exposed an impressive cross-section. This will allow us to get a perfect look at the structure of an A'a lava flow. When these type of flows are active, the core of the flow is fluid and the rubbly clinker rides on top. The liquid core acts like a conveyor belt moving downslope, carrying the rubbly stuff with it. You can clearly see that structure in this photograph, with the core appearing as the dense, solid bottom and the characteristic chunky rubbly stuff on top. This next photograph is of another area that has been exposed by the rebuilding of Highway 132. In this one, we can see a cross-section of Fissure 8's channel levee wall. This levee was built by overflowing Pahoehoe lava as it splashed and spilled over the rim while the molten rock rushed to the ocean. This activity is distinctly illustrated by the thin layers of Pahoehoe lava seen in this photograph. Taking a quick look at this image, we are looking downstream along the side of one of the two channels in the area. This part of the lava channel is approximately 200 feet or 60 meters wide. In this last picture, we are looking at the channel wall in the braided part of the Fissure 8 channel. The levee wall here is around 20 feet or 6 meters high, though if we move just upstream from here, the channel is about 250 feet or 75 meters wide. The enormous scale of the lava river channel is proof of the extraordinarily high rates of flowing lava. It exceeded a speed of over 100 cubic meters per second. Well, I hope you enjoyed this bonus content, as that concludes this edition of the Hawaii Volcano Watch Report. Mahalo for watching, and have an amazing morning, afternoon, or evening.